Good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting of the Health and Sport Committee. I would ask everyone in the room to ensure that their mobile phones are on silent. It's acceptable to use mobile devices for social media within the room, but please don't take photographs or film proceedings. The first item on the agenda is subordinate legislation with two negative instruments. The first instrument is the National Health Service Dietary Supplement Prescribers and Therapeutic Radiographer Independent Prescribers Miscellaneous Amendment, Scotland Regulations 2016, SSI 2016-393. There's been no motion to annul, however, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee have made comments on the instrument and they draw attention of Parliament to under reporting ground H on the basis that the instrument could be made clearer in the following respects. Under I in Regulation 3B2, the word or could be used instead of and at the end of subparagraph F of the definition of prescriber in Regulation 2.1 of the NHS General Medical Services Contract, Scotland Regulations 2004. This would put beyond doubt that the subcategories listed in that definition are alternatives and not cumulative. The second point is two, on the basis in Regulation 6B2, the word or could be used instead of and at the end of subparagraph F of the definition prescriber in Regulation 2.1 of the NHS Primary Services Section 17C Agreements, Scotland Regulations 2004. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee have confirmed that no changes shall be made by the Scottish Government. I invite any comments from members. No, everyone satisfied. Is it agreed that the committee make no recommendations? Okay, that is agreed. Thanks very much. The second instrument is the Patient Rights, Complaints Procedure and Consequential Provisions, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016, SSI 2016-401. There's been no motion to annul and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has not made any comment on the instrument. Again, could I invite any comments from members? No. Has the committee agreed to make no recommendations? That is agreed, thank you. The second item on the agenda is an evidence session on the draft budget 2017-18. Could I welcome to the committee Shona Robison, Cabinet Secretary for Health and Sport, Christine McLaughlin, Director of Health Finance, and Paul Gray, Director General Health and Social Care and Chief Executive NHS Scotland, all from the Scottish Government. Could I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement? And I think, as agreed with your office, you would make some reference to climate change issues in your statement as well. Cabinet Secretary.
Okay, well, thanks, Convener. And thanks for the invitation to discuss the draft budget for 2017-18. I welcome the opportunity to give evidence this morning on this very important subject, ensuring that there's fair and appropriate funding for the National Health Service, an asset, of course, that is precious to us all. Over the next few years, the demand for health and social care and the circumstances in which it's delivered will be radically different. NHS Scotland must work with its partners across the public and voluntary sectors to ensure that it continues to provide the high-quality health and care services that the people of Scotland expect and deserve, securing the best possible outcomes for people through the care and support they receive. As I've highlighted before, the NHS simply can't stand still but has to continually evolve to deliver the best medicine, the best care, always ensuring public money is spent as effectively as possible. It's with that in mind that we published yesterday our delivery plan for health and social care. That plan brings together the key programmes of change for ensuring that our health and social care system can meet these new challenges, particularly the National Clinical Strategy, Health and Social Care Integration and Public Health Improvement. The delivery plan sets out high-level actions and we look forward to working closely with COSLA, employers and staff-side partners in NHS Scotland and a range of others to deliver our aspirations. At the core of that delivery plan and our overall approach are the twin themes of investment and reform, and these themes are also at the heart of this budget. In addition to providing extra financial resources, we will continue to drive forward our significant programme of reform, and this budget sets the framework for our next steps. We have consistently prioritised investment in the NHS and have increased frontline spend, health spending between 2010-11 and 2017-18 by 9.3% in real terms. In 2017-18, funding for our core NHS budgets will increase by over £320 million, more than the Barnet consequentials for health, which was £304 million. Also, through an additional £50 million to be directed to NRAC parity, no board will be further than 1% from parity in 2017-18. And this reflects the priority this government places in protecting frontline services and ensuring an equitable distribution of resources, and will continue to demonstrate this central priority moving forward. The NHS revenue budget will be almost £2 billion higher at the end of this parliament than at the outset. Our commitment to integrating health and social care services is demonstrated in this budget, with additional investment of over £100 million to be allocated to health and social care partnerships. This will bring the additional NHS investment in health and social care integration up to almost £500 million in 2017-18, allowing key services to be delivered differently, with greater emphasis on supporting people in their own homes and communities. As well as progress with integration, this budget sets out further measures to shift the balance of care by increasing, in every year of this Parliament, the share of the NHS budget dedicated to mental health and to primary, community and social care. This budget represents an important step to ensuring that by 2021-22, more than half of frontline NHS spending will be in community health services. We'll invest £72 million in improvements to primary care and GP services, going towards an additional £500 million being invested in this area each year by the end of this Parliament. By 2021-22, we'll increase spending on primary care to 11% of the frontline NHS budget. In 2017-18, investment in mental health will exceed £1 billion for the first time. And we'll see mental health investment exceed £5 billion over this Parliament. This will help underpin our new 10-year mental health strategy, which will be firmly based on the principles of ask once, get help fast. Our capital investment programme will ensure that the NHS estate is equipped for the challenges ahead. We'll invest over £200 million in the NHS estate, focusing on improving primary care facilities, maintaining and updating medical equipment, and replacing key vehicles such as ambulances. Furthermore, we'll prioritise investment in the new Dumfries and Galloway Royal Infirmary, this new Sick Children's Hospital and Department of Clinical Neurosciences in Edinburgh, and the Baird Family Hospital and Anchor Centre in Aberdeen. The draft budget also commits to progression on our £200 million commitment to expand the Golden Jubilee Hospital and create five elective care centres in Aberdeen, Dundee, Edinburgh, Inverness and Livingston. This will, for example, allow us to meet the increasing demand for hip and knee replacements and cataract operations. Dedicated elective capacity will help tackle the knock-on effect that peaks in demand from unscheduled emergency patients can have on planned elective care. Convener, in this global and interconnected world, it's more important than ever that we all consider the impact of our work on wider issues, in particular that of climate change. The NHS, Scottish Futures Trust and Scottish Government have been working closely in partnership to develop and procure a Scottish energy efficiency framework, which will permit vital energy efficiency work to be carried out using both capital and revenue funding. Recent capital funding has been directed to a number of NHS capital projects, such as the replacement of boilers in the Glasgow Royal Infirmary and St John's Hospital in Livingston to improve energy efficiency. And in 2017-18, we're planning to provide capital investment of £1.8 million to energy efficiency projects in NHS Tayside and NHS Ayrshire and Arran to help lower our carbon emissions. Convener, I conclude with my opening comments around investment and reform. It's through this approach of continued investment and reform that will set the basis for delivering the 2020 vision and our longer-term strategy up to 2030 through the delivery plan that we have published. This will ensure a safe, sustainable and person-centred NHS for the people of Scotland. This draft budget for 2017-18 puts in place the framework to enable us to achieve this vision, and on this basis I commend it to you.
Thanks very much for your statement. In the budget document, we have a 0.6% increase in real terms in the allocation. Audit Scotland said that the rate for health inflation is 3.1%. So are we in effect seeing a cut?
Well, first of all, NHS territorial board budgets will increase by 2.8% in 2017-18. That includes the baseline uplift and NRAC parity and baseline transfers. If you look at the health service inflation, figure is
2.3%.
So the allocation to territorial boards is higher than the inflation for 17-18. Of course, what is required through the reform process, which I have laid out very clearly in the delivery plan that we published yesterday, is the need for us to continue to drive efficiency to make sure, for example, that we can invest in the transformation that we require to invest in. And that's why, for example, in 17-18, there's £128 million going into a change fund that will help us shift the balance of care from the acute sector and hospital-based services into the community. So although there is an above inflation increase for boards, we also recognise that the services that are delivered need to change in order to maintain the quality.
Across the health and sport budget, the allocation in total is £13.2 billion, which represents a 2% increase or a 0.6% real terms increase. At the same time, Audit Scotland's figure is that health inflation is 3.1%.
Are these 2016-17, it decreases to 2.3% in 17-18.
So there's still a gap then between 0.6 and 2.3?
Well, no, because the territorial budgets are receiving 2.8%, which is higher than 2.3%.
I'm talking about across the piece. Well, £13.2 billion across the whole area of your responsibility, and that increases 0.6.
Could I clarify, because you're right that there's a distinction between the board uplifts and then some transfers into their baselines in next year. I think the point that we've tried to make in the budget document is that there's a contribution towards inflationary pressures and there's also investment in reform next year. So what we could have done is put all of the money just into board uplifts for inflationary pressures. We've tried to target some of it for investment, primary care, mental health and so on. And so we thought it was appropriate that we recognise both of them. That's why we talk about investment of £128 million in year. If you take that into account, then it's more than an inflationary increase.
Because that money is money the boards will get in year, but it's directed through a change fund in order to make sure that the direction of travel is an investment in community health services. But it's money that the boards will still receive.
In terms of efficiencies, efficiencies would suggest that money has been used more effectively. If I look at NHS Tayside or NHS Lothian, take NHS Lothian, 70% of its targets are being missed in as reported in its recent board papers. 70%. Do you think the efficiencies that are being made there are effective?
Well, I certainly understand that efficiency savings can be challenging for boards to deliver, but if we're going to shift the balance of care, and if we're going to make sure that services are funded within the community, then we need to ensure that services are delivered in the most efficient way. But if you take, for example, Lothian's NRAC uplift for 2017-18, they are getting the lion's share of the £50 million. It's 19.2 million pounds. So Lothian will get a 3% uplift. So although it is still tough for boards, I think this is a fair settlement for the NHS that will require not just a significant investment, but it will require reform alongside that. And you know, we have delivered what we committed to deliver in our manifesto, which was the £500 million above inflation commitment. That was by far the highest level of commitment of any of the manifestos, and that's what we will deliver. But it will require efficiency savings from boards.
My final point before I move on. If they are getting, as you say, more money, and they are becoming more efficient, yet they are missing more and more of their performance targets and criteria. What do you say to patients and staff in, for example, Lothian, who are being told that more money is going in, being told that these are all efficiencies, and yet the system, the services that they are provide appear to be getting worse?
Well, look, Convener, we laid out our funding commitments to the NHS in our manifesto and were elected upon that during the election. It was 30 million more than, for example, the commitments of parties to inflation-only increases. So if we had gone down that line, there would have been less money in the NHS. But of course, the performance targets of the NHS are tough. There is more demand on our services, which is why, of course, we need to make sure that every penny and every pound that goes into our health and social care services is delivered as efficiently as possible. Yesterday, I laid out a very clear delivery plan of how we would make sure that as much of that resource goes to the front line as possible. And of course, we need to make sure that what we measure in terms of outcomes for patients are the right measurements, which is why the work that Harry Burns is undertaking is so important. But despite all of that, and some of those targets, as you have said, have been missed, the performance of the NHS is still a very, very good performance, delivering some of the lowest waiting times we have seen in a long time. So I think what I would say to the public and patients is that the NHS is still delivering a very, very good service, but in order to make sure it continues to do so, given the increasing demands of an ageing population, we need to reform the way services are delivered, and that's what the delivery plan I published yesterday lays out.
Alex.
Thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and good morning to the rest of the panel. I would like to pick up on something I've discussed with you previously, which is specifically funding to drug and alcohol partnerships. We know that in the last Scottish budget, those services received a cut of up to 22%, and in my own region of Lothian, in Edinburgh City, that equates to a 1.3 million year-on-year cut. Now, I understand that the Scottish Government have asked that the local health boards deliver the services up to the standard that they did before and find money to displace to make that happen. But as I've just said, in the circumstance of Lothian, that isn't happening. And we know that's not also not happening in Glasgow, where since that cut happened, we have already started to see an HIV outbreak among intravenous drug users. I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary can walk us through any particular aspects of the budget which mitigate that, which put money back into drug and alcohol partnerships, and what the future prognosis for those services looks like.
Well, first of all, it's important to say that, and I think as I've sat here and said before, that the most important thing here is what is delivered in terms of outcomes for those requiring access to alcohol and drug services, and the performance around the waiting time standards that we've just been talking about on alcohol and drug waiting times and access to treatment is very, very good. And it's important that boards maintain that level. But with regard to Lothian in particular, and I know this is an issue you have raised consistently, as I just said in my previous answer around NHS Lothian's allocation in 2017, contains 19.2 million pounds of NRAC uplift. That is by far the highest level within the NRAC allocation of the £50 million. Now, what we are intending to do is to discuss with boards, particularly those boards that are going to be gaining a significant investment from NRAC that they did not necessarily expect to receive, is to discuss with boards what that resource should be spent on, and our intention with Lothian would be to include within that a discussion around ADP funding to make sure that it is adequate to deliver the outcomes required, and that at the level that we could come to some agreement on. Now, I'd be happy to keep you informed about that, but there will be other elements as well within the agreement around their LDP that we would want to see Lothian improve upon, particularly some of the performance measures that the convener mentioned earlier on. But that is a significant additional fund that is available to Lothian that we think part of which we would like to discuss with them around alcohol and drug funding.
Thank you for that. I mean, my contention would be that whilst outcomes still look pretty good, mm-hmm. we're only measuring them for the spending that we were doing before mm-hmm. that cut really properly mm-hmm. came in and took hold. And as I mentioned, you know, with an HIV outbreak in Glasgow and other things happening in other parts of the country where ADP funding has reduced, we may see that that is problematic. But I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for those assurances. I look forward to hearing more information about that. Can I just ask briefly, if I may, Convener, about mental health mm-hmm. Funding and specifics within that? Obviously, I think everybody around this table would welcome the increase in funding towards mental health. Can you specifically cover two areas, which is in terms of child and adolescent mental health service, what sort of percentage of that spend will be directed at child and adolescent mental health services, particularly in reducing waiting times and access to tier 4 beds? And also, if you could, I've recently been quoted in the media talking about the need for mental health first aid and looking at upskilling our workforce in mental health first aid. Could you possibly cover those two issues?
Well, a lot of the detail of what the priorities for mental health spend will, of course, be part of the strategy going forward. And I know there's been engagement around that by Maureen Watt, the Mental Health Minister. I think we're always open to suggestions around how we could deliver and develop new services within the community. You'll have seen at the weekend, Maureen Watt was talking about the £10 million for primary care services, for mental health services within primary care. And I think importantly as well, the delivery plan that I announced yesterday focused very much on that shift in spend to community health services, including primary care, mental health and social care. Within all of that, there is scope to develop many innovative services for mental health, whether that's within schools, within primary care, and indeed to improve some of the services within our emergency services that are responding to people who are in crisis. So this is a draft budget. There is further scope to discuss some of the detail. We've set out a number of priority areas for mental health spend. It is quite a substantial additional spend over the course of this Parliament. But, you know, if there are specific issues and detail and suggestions around some of that spend, then, you know, those discussions can be had in further detail.
Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, for joining us this morning. I think your government had anticipated that by 2016-17, no board would be below NRAC parity level. And I appreciate your comments regarding the increase, particularly in Lothian, but it is still below parity, as are seven other health boards. And I'd just like to ask if the government is still committed to NRAC parity and what the timescale is for achieving that, if you are.
Well, as I said in my opening remarks, all boards in 2017-18, all boards will be within 1% of parity. And that funding will mean that since 2012-13, an additional £884 million has been committed over a six-year period to those boards below the NRAC parity levels. That's a significant investment. And that will continue to make sure that boards are kept at least within 1% of parity. And, you know, the investment, the £50 million in 2017, will make a big difference, particularly to those boards like NHS Lothian, which has had a number of challenges. Christine, do you want to add in?
Yeah, just a couple of things, if I could. I think one is that what we're really keen to see is that additional funding gets used for investment. So if I look at NHS Grampian over the last few years, they've really taken additional NRAC funding and treated it as and not money just going to the bottom line for their pressures, but they've invested it in services. And I think that's what we'd like to see across these boards, that they really get something that you can see that helps make services more sustainable. A couple of other things. One is that in making those kind of decisions about going for a lower level of uplift for all boards, on a cumulative basis, you really start to see the impact of that. And when we talk about the in-year funding, so the 128 million that goes to boards, the more that we start to shift that money in a way that fits with NRAC parity, if you understand, what, you know, so rather than giving it out on funding, actually giving it out on shares, you start to make bigger inroads into that shift. So with every element of additional funding that goes to boards, we always look at it to see whether we can continue to help move closer towards that parity. The final thing I would say is that we've also said to boards that we would give them a three-year forecast to give more certainty about what the NRAC position would look like for the next few years. So we will be, as part of finalising the budget, we'll give all boards the forecast position of their shares for the next 3 years based on current population trends. And if you look at that, you'll see, for instance, that an area like Lothian, population trends continue to forecast an upward rise of a growth of about 0.5% every year. So we would expect to continue to put more money in over the next few years. But getting to 1%, I think, is for all boards in this way, is the closest we've been since that commitment was made.
Thank you. On another issue, there's been a significant cut to the sports budget, 7% in cash terms and 8.3% in real terms, which is obviously of great concern to many of the governing bodies and to people delivering sports in our communities. I think we're aware that all the international research suggests that a major global games is no guarantee that we'll see a significant increase in people participating, but I think cuts of this scale certainly won't help. I just wondered if the Cabinet Secretary has been in discussion with the governing bodies and others about the impact this will have.
Well, certainly Aileen Campbell, as the Minister for Public Health and Sport, has been. I mean, it is a tough settlement. We would, though, expect Sport Scotland to focus on the delivery of grassroots sport and community sport in terms of prioritisation. The commitment to increase the community sports hubs is important. I think also, though, we need to see some of the other investments in early years and public health measures as being also important. The investment, the new diet and obesity strategy, the investment in through education and PE, the active schools network, all of these things, I think we would want to make sure are prioritised. I think also there are other parts of government that contribute to sport for major sporting events through Events Scotland, for example. We've also just seen today a pretty significant announcement around tennis investment next year, a partnership between the Lawn Tennis Association and Sport Scotland, a £15 million investment. So it is a tough settlement. We will continue to talk to Sport Scotland and the governing bodies. I am aware that there's also lottery pressures, which are obviously additional. Happy to have further discussions, but we would expect them to, within that tough settlement, prioritise grassroots and community sport.
Okay. Can I ask one more question, Convener? With regard to other investments and other parts of government, I think it's fair to say that those groups who lobby for greater investment in active travel infrastructure are disappointed, to say the least, that there's been an increase in trunk roads budget, which is four times the size of the entire active travel budget. And we heard from Ian Finlay from Paths for All in our session on obesity that physical inactivity is costing the NHS, costing the country £94 million a year. I'm just wondering if climate change and health are cross-cutting government priorities, is there an opportunity for you to speak with the Transport Minister, perhaps, and suggest that this is revised in an upward direction before we come to vote on any budget?
I think what is fair to say is that we need to make sure across government, and I have had discussions with the previous Transport Minister and the current Transport Minister and other ministers across government about how do we better coordinate our work to be more cohesive and coherent around trying to get tackling some of the big issues of the day, such as obesity. I guess, though, that's got to, you know, government is always about balance and about making sure we're also investing in some of our infrastructure that needs investment. And, you know, these things are always about striking the right balance. But, you know, happy to continue those discussions around active travel. I think there are perhaps opportunities as we revise our obesity strategy next year to look at that in more detail and how we can encourage people onto public transport, walking, cycling. And of course, there has been investment in our in cycle infrastructure. We have, I think, investment of 39.2 million per year in active travel, which, you know, is not insignificant, but again, it's a draft budget and happy to continue to have those discussions.
Yeah, I would just like to emphasise the point that you know, 39.2 million hasn't increased at all, but the Trunks Roads budget has increased four times that of the entire active travel budget. So I would be grateful for any conversations you might have.
Okay.
Thank you.
Just briefly, what's the thought process behind sport getting such a significant cut? What's the logic of that?
It's a tough budget in that we need to make sure that we are able to prioritise the areas of investment which I have made clear are around community health services. We have, though, prioritised investment around early years, around making sure that some of the preventive work that we do within health, within our health services, is prioritised. And within sport, we've said we want priority given to grassroots and the active schools element. This is about having to set a tough set of priorities.
It's a priority. It's just prioritisation. Okay. Donald.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and panel. I'd like to ask about the 500 million additional funding to primary care. And just to make one thing clear at the start, is your commitment one which is that you will invest 500 million additionally each year by 2021? Have I got that right?
It's 500 million over the course of this Parliament,
right,
into primary care, and that will deliver an 11% share of the budget. So this next year, the budget into primary care is going to 72 million.
Yes.
Increases. Now, some of that is obviously, the breakdown of that includes the GP contractual uplift and population growth, but importantly, it also includes the investment in the new models of primary care. And that is about about delivering the new vision of primary care that we want to see, which is the multidisciplinary team working. So
it's 500 million over the course of the Parliament.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
And in terms of the 72 million, which you've just referred to,
mm-hmm,
are you able to give any breakdown as to primary care, general practice, etc., at this stage?
The team have been working on the prioritisation of that investment. It isn't yet finalised, but I think we'd be happy to share what's within it, because there are quite a lot of different components. So there's certain areas that were part of GP investment, but there's also some investment in some digital technologies and in the implementation of the out-of-hours reviews. So there's quite a lot within it, as well as some funding for resources on the ground and in partnerships to try out some of the new models of care. So a whole raft of things that make up that 72 million pounds. So I think once we've got that in a slightly more advanced stage, but not very near into the new year, be able to share that with you. And also happy to share with you where we are in terms of that shift and what we're looking at for next year. I think it's important to distinguish between the funding that goes in, but also the expenditure on the ground. And we're doing quite a lot of work to try to understand how we'd see those flows and what kind of reporting we'll have against them. So anything like that you'd like to see, we'd be happy to give you more information on.
Well, I'd very much like that information. I'm sure the committee would too. In terms of, I think the phrase used by the Cabinet Secretary last week, Derek Mackay, was improvement plan. Is that just a general ambition to improve general practice in primary care, or is there a concrete improvement plan itself?
Well, the changes to primary care are a critical part of the delivery plan that we published yesterday. I mean, we've talked for quite a few months now with the profession, with the BMA, around the negotiation of the new contract and what that's going to deliver, but also the wider investment in primary care that's about ensuring that we build up the workforce around the multidisciplinary team. And of course, there'll be more of that in the workforce plan in the spring. And making sure that we are delivering not just a funding plan, but a reform plan as well, which is why the new model of primary care is so important. Now, there are also short-term measures and funding to address things like recruitment and retention, supporting clusters. So there are elements of the funding that are very much around the here and now, I guess, and there are elements of the funding which are more about transformation.
Okay. Richard.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. There are many questions I can ask you about the budget, but there's two particular items which I've always been interested in. One is, as you know, I've continually pressed the case of patients who have been contaminated with contaminated blood products. I notice the budget hasn't changed any. Can you tell me what position we're at with? And you gave me an answer before at the end of the last session of the last Parliament in regards to the payment programme for patients with contaminated blood. Can you tell me where we are at the moment? Is it still being held back by the UK government?
So the latest is that progress is being made on making sure we have some interim arrangements to be able to make those additional payments to those affected. And we have, my officials are at quite an advanced stage of discussions with the funds down south and Department of Health officials to try and get that money into the hands of people as quickly as possible. But the second strand of this is obviously the setting up of the Scottish scheme. I'm confident that we'll have that up and running within 17-18 to be able to deliver the more comprehensive package of support to those affected. I think in total the package is about 20 million.
Yeah, that's right.
So it is a significant investment, but what's important is that the money gets into the hands of those affected. So a lot of work being done to try and do that as quickly as possible. We've been working with stakeholders as well around what the new Scottish scheme will look like and making sure there's patient involvement in that. And happy to keep you posted as we take those.
So basically, again, there are no effect to this extra money. The sooner it's paid out, the better, I have to say to you, and constantly will press you in regard to that matter.
Yeah.
But there'll be no effect on local budgets, local NHS.
No, both. This is being funded centrally.
Directly by government. Mm-hmm. Okay. Second question, convener, is we went through integrated joint boards. We identified that there would be savings of, I think, if my memory serves me right, 140 million, which I don't think we're going to see. But and the concern I had was some joint boards actually still hadn't made up their budgets by October, November of this year. And we're now predicting they'll be able to do it next year. Do we have total confidence that integrated boards are doing that, and what monitoring will you be having on their budgets? Do we have someone checking on integrated boards to ensure that they are meeting their responsibilities?
So I'll let Christine answer in a bit more detail in a minute, but we have tried to make improvements around the budget setting process, because you're right, there were certainly some challenges with that. The statutory guidance requires 3-year budgets with a review of years 2 and 3 carried out on an annual basis, and boards and councils are adjusting their budget setting processes really to fit with that cycle, and that entails a greater adjustment from health boards really in making estimates for medium-term assumptions and associated risks. A lot of work going on with directors of finance. Christine, you have more of the detail on that. Do you want to?
So largely we expect those timing issues to have been year one transitional issues, and I'm certainly assured from conversations with the Integration Authority Chief Officer, Chief Finance Officers, that they feel in a clearer position in terms of their plans for next year. And even the fact that in getting to agreement on the draft budget, I think we're much more joined up between the discussions that we've had between health, local government and integration authorities. So those kind of reasons of people being unclear about the settlement, I think we can start to see real improvements in that. Clearly, there'll still be the work with integration authorities about how they deliver their plans, but I would still have an expectation that the integration authorities, as with all other public bodies, should be in a position for the beginning of the year to have much greater clarity on their the plans, their overall levels of funding and the plans that they need to operate within that.
And just lastly on that same subject, Convener, are we going to ensure that we have that we go through integrated joint boards to ensure that they are given value for money?
Well, we, through the Ministry of Strategic Group, I'm actually chairing a meeting tomorrow, I think it is. The remit of that group has changed really to give a bit of a sharper focus to how we oversee performance and how we support partnerships to develop best practice, how we share best practice, how we support them through improvement teams to make the changes that need to be made if they're not delivering where we think they should be, or collectively, I mean, with local government and third sector partners, everybody sits around that table jointly responsible to make sure that we deliver and they deliver what we need to see delivered. And if you look at, for example, on delayed discharge, as I've said before, if all partnerships were delivering at the rate and of the top 25%, which are a mix of partnerships, some rural, some urban, then we would be able to halve the numbers of delay just by doing that. So there are things we know work. We are keen to help partnerships to make those changes, and the role of the Ministerial Strategic Group in having oversight and support is hopefully going to make a difference.
So just to add to that, so the just over £8 billion that's within the remit of the integration authorities, that's integral to the sustainability and value programme for the NHS, and so savings programmes and efficiencies in areas like prescribing, for example, are wholly dependent on the integration authorities being part of the solution for that. So I think we see much more the kind of line between bodies being much more fluid, so that we're all working together on that programme overall. But I think I would see it as how do we get the best value for the £8 billion rather than looking at one subset within it. And we really start to see some differences and some really good examples of changes in ways of working coming through integration authorities. in the way in which they're treating people in their own homes in particular, that we really need to see that accelerate through next year, and that's what our focus will be on.
Thank you, Kadeena.
In the committee's report, we said that we wanted to see some action on aligning of budgets, but the response was that there was, you know, your view that there was no need to issue any new guidance on that. Are you confident that we won't see that this time round?
On aligning of budgets, they're entirely aligned, I would say now, and that's why in looking at the funding letters that went out last week with the budget, we were completely consistent in the message to all bodies. So those types of reasons are not there anymore. So the only reason I can see in which we wouldn't have a signed off budget at the start of the year is if there is still some work to do on understanding some of the savings programmes that would need to be put in place, but there should be no process reason in relation to not getting information about budgets at the same time, if that answers your question.
We'll watch that with interest. Miles.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Last year, NHS Scotland spent £248 million on locum doctors and nurses. That was a £41 million increase on the previous year. What does the Cabinet Secretary believe that will be in 18-19, and will it increase?
Well, our aim would be to reduce that spend, and part of the national programme that Christine and her team are involved with boards is very much about driving down those agency costs. If you look at actually one of the boards that has been delivering a significant reduction in agency spend, because actually they had one of the highest, is NHS Tayside. And what we would expect is the best practice of how to do that is shared across boards. The Chief Nursing Officer, Fiona McQueen, has been working with boards as well around getting the balance of filling some of those substantive posts. And she's been working with directors of nursing within boards to look at how that can be done in a helpful and meaningful way. But Christine's, you can say a bit more about the national programme, but this is a really, really important priority for driving down.
Yeah, and we've given some direction to boards this year in the Strath budget, and looking at how the money is used next year in areas that we expect to see improvements, and spend on agencies and locums is one of those areas. So overall, what we're saying is we expect to see a minimum 25% reduction next year. And I think there's two aspects to that. One is about where you need to use agencies, that you do it in the most effective way. But ultimately, the benefit comes from managing your need for staffing provision and to look at alternative ways. And so that's why things like introducing a regional bank for medical staff is absolutely critical that they are in place. Because what we're seeing is that we're not getting that reduction in locum spend until things like that are in place as a substitute. So I think that we're much further on in that, and I really expect to see some reductions. It will probably vary across the country because it will be about local circumstances in individual boards, but we really do expect that 25% to be a realistic target for next year.
My second point was regarding the use of the private and independent sector. How much has been spent this year on patients having to be treated in the private and independent sector, and what's the projections for future years? Will that also be increasing?
Well, it's actually reduced this year and is reducing. When we launched the £200 million plan for elective centre development, which of course is over the course of this Parliament, we were explicit that one of the reasons for doing that was to further reduce spend on the private and independent sector by having that elective capacity there to meet the needs of the population, particularly a growing elderly population of hips, knees, cataracts, and so on and so forth. The use of the private and independent sector has been used by some boards more than others. But we would only ever expect it to be used at the margins, and there's never a replacement for capacity in the NHS. But we do recognise the need for additional elective capacity, and that's why we're going to have those additional five centres in addition to the Golden Jubilee, but I would anticipate less spend on the private and independent sector. Do you?
Yeah, it's something that I don't have the detail yet until we see the plans from the boards, and we've just given them a settlement. We'll start to see that in January and February next year. But we also know that there are things like there's a real theatre improvement programme going on just now to look at how you can increase your number of procedures in a day in a theatre. And things like that as well can really have an impact on your need to use additional capacity. And so that's what some of the work through the National Clinical Strategy is really starting to make inroads in. But there's some really good improvements in areas like NHS Lothian, a lot of looking at practice in areas like the National Waiting Time Centre, where the number of operations in a session is higher in some particular specialties. So I think it's those types of things that we'll see an overall reduction in the independent sector.
Okay, Colin.
Cabinet Secretary, in your opening statement, you included the £107 million for social care in the overall figure you gave for health spending. So can you just confirm that the £107 million is for the health budget and not for local government budget?
Well, the £107 million is being transferred through the health budget into the integrated authorities, which is what we've done with the £250 million. So it's basically been done on the same basis, given that we now have an integrated system. That's clearly about moving out of silos, and the £107 million is transferring through the health budget into the integrated authorities.
But in the budget document and in your statement earlier, you included £107 million in the overall figure for health, the health budget. But can you explain then why, if you look at the budget document published by the government, page 101, that funding for health and social care is also included in local government's budget, and for the first time under the column other sources of support? That didn't happen last year, so why is it happening this year? Does that not surely lead to accusations of double counting?
Well, no, I don't think there is double counting. I mean, we've been clear in our statements that the £107 million, in the same way as the £250 million, is allocated to the health budget and then transferring into the new integrated authorities. I don't think that could be clearer, Chrissy.
What we're actually trying to do is make it as transparent as possible. So the language, I think, is very clear. The issue, I think, with integration authorities is they don't get a budget as part of this budget settlement. Their budget comes through health and local government. So actually, I think we felt that it was it wasn't really about whether the money sits within the health part of the portfolio or local government. The funds are transferring to the integration authorities, and that's what we're trying to be really clear on, that funding transfers to integration authorities. And the reflection in local government isn't adding to the value of the settlement. It's showing as an other source of funding because it flows through from health. And I might be just being a bit pedantic, but it's only included once in the overall numbers. It's included in the health settlement. It's not included in local government as part of the settlement, but it's shown there, if you like, below the line as a source of additional income that's flowing through from health. But it's absolutely only counted once in our overall financial settlement on the budget.
Well, you certainly confirmed to me that it is contained within the health budget, and therefore it can also be contained in local government budgets as well.
It's within the world of integration, which is surely a good thing that we're seeing that as one system instead of two systems, I would have thought.
But obviously the money can't be spent twice, so
I don't think anyone's claiming it is.
I would beg to differ, but if you look at the actual £107 million, it's obviously largely ring-fenced for specific purposes, in particular the living wage. Can you confirm that you're happy that the funding that's been provided this year for the living wage in all IGB areas is going to be sufficient to cover the full cost of living wage? I welcome the fact, for example, that previous, I think, bizarre assumptions about 25% of the cost being provided by the provider themselves is not going to be removed. So can you confirm that funding will fully cover the full cost of the living wage? And could you also explain specifically what the £10 million is for sleepover shifts? What exactly will this cover? Because obviously it wouldn't cover the full living wage for a sleepover shift. So what will the £10 million actually cover?
So the £80 million to support the continued delivery of the living wage is important. That enables the increased rate of £8.45 per hour to be paid and to care workers supporting adults in care homes and care at home housing support settings, should now include where it hasn't already, adult daycare workers and personal assistants through arrangements made where care is provided. That the figure of £80 million and the £10 million that's been identified for sleepovers has been based on negotiation and looking at what the cost is with local government and third sector providers. Now, it has been worked. There's been a huge amount of work actually going in to make sure that we can get that as accurately estimated as possible, but we'll continue to work with COSLA and third sector providers as we take that through the year to make sure that that can be delivered. I think it is a substantial investment in making sure that I think 40,000 workers will continue to receive the living wage and will deal with the issue of sleepovers, which I know has been raised by yourself and others within this committee.
What I'm not clear about is what exactly will the £10 million cover? If you look at the number of sleepover shifts, it won't cover the full cost of paying somebody, for example, the living wage for a sleepover shift. So I'm not sure how that £10 million come about. What will it actually specifically cover?
So it was agreed that all waking hours would be paid at the living wage, with sleepover hours being paid at an average for all hours of the national living wage over the week. It's been agreed that this position remain as part of the offer for 2017-18, and that's going to allow time for reform to take place and more work to be done between ourselves, COSLA, and the third sector on making sure that we can continue to make sure that that is delivered. I think where there are concerns has been around ensuring that those who are vulnerable receiving sleepover support, that continues to be the case, and that's the most important thing as we take forward those discussions. So work in progress, I would say.
Could you explain that part again? Because I certainly missed that. You skated over quite quickly. What does that, in practical terms, mean for staff doing sleepovers? Because you're saying it's only covering waking hours. What does that mean?
It's part of a negotiation that's still going forward, I think.
So at the moment, what the position at the moment, as you describe it, what is that?
Well, it's been agreed that all, and this has been agreed as a kind of interim basis as we take forward these discussions, all waking hours will be paid at the living wage, with sleepover hours being paid at an average for all hours over the week. So it's basically averaging out the hours over the week, and that it's been agreed that this position remain part of the offer for 2017-18 to allow time for further discussions to take place with providers and with COSLA. Happy to provide more detail on that, because
it
is work in progress.
Because I'm no clearer,
right,
and
okay.
That's maybe just me, and it wouldn't surprise me if it was.
It is complex and it is detailed, and you'll appreciate that there are ongoing discussions with the sector and with local government around trying to make sure that we give a fair position to those who are working in a sleepover.
It might be helpful if you were to provide that, and maybe provide an example of Mr.
Fine.
Or Mrs. Smith and
Fine.
Their hours and how how it would work for them.
Okay.
Sorry, Colin.
Happy to do that.
I think that certainly would be helpful, because what you've described is obviously the current situation around HMRC rules, but it's how we move forward is still not clear. Obviously, most of the £107 million that you've described is therefore ring-fenced, £87 million, £80 million for the living wage, £7 million for changes in care charges, so it's largely ring-fenced. So can you explain why the Cabinet Secretary of Finance wrote to local government leaders last week sanctioning effectively an £80 million cut in the contribution from local government to IGBs, because that will obviously more than cancel out any additional funding that's been provided in the £107 million, given the fact that most of it is obviously ring-fenced.
Well, first of all, I think it's important to look at the global amount that has gone into integration. So the 250 million last year in 16-17 continues to be provided into integration authorities. In addition, in 17-18, there's another £107 million, albeit that the focus on that has been to deliver the living wage, I think quite rightly. But, you know, within integrated authorities, there will need to be efficiency savings and reforms around how those integrated authorities work to make sure that all of the resource that they are getting is delivering to the front line. So although more money is going into integrated authorities, they will require, as health boards are requiring, to change some of the way that they operate. So I think it is important through the delivery plan that we published yesterday to recognise that as well as investment, reform is the other side of the coin, and that's what we'll be working with integrated authorities to deliver.
We're very short of time, so we need to be... Are you finished, Colin? Ivan?
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary, for coming along. First, I mean, there's a couple of things I just wanted to touch on. The first one was just to clarify, right back at the start, we spoke about the overall picture and the numbers. And just to be clear, if I'm reading this correctly, what it's saying is that in cash terms, the overall budget is up £267 million, it's 2.1%. And in real terms, which means over and above inflation, it's up 0.6%, which is £79 million. So if I'm reading that right, then the 0.6 million and the 0.6% increase is after inflation's been taken into account. And the £79 million is the first step to the manifesto commitment of increasing health spend budget by £500 million over the lifetime of the Parliament. That's correct, yeah. Because I think earlier on there was some confusion about the 0.6 and then trying to say that that was in cash terms, not in real terms, but that's in real terms. Yeah, that's clear.
Just clarify the point I was making. That's in general inflation rates, not health inflation rates. Yeah.
Right, which is 2.3% versus 2.1. Right. Okay, so that's just to clarify that. But as you also correctly said, at the end of the day, what this is all about is outcomes. It doesn't really matter how much money we put in or don't put in. It's what gets delivered from the health service and from the process as a result of that. So I was really just wanting to drill down a wee bit in a couple of areas. One round about how we're measuring what boards are delivering, given that there's a target review in place, given that there's a national performance framework there, given that there's outcome measures, there's a number of different frameworks there for measuring things. So how we're drilling down to measure boards and taking best practice across boards, and how we're dealing, or you're dealing with boards that aren't delivering what they should be doing. And also, what's the efficiency process? And by that, I mean, how are we identifying best practice? How are we getting that transferred across the piece? And again, being clear, efficiency in my mind means delivering more for the same or less, which is different from cuts. So talking about how we identify areas where we can deliver more for the same money or less money across the piece.
Well, there's clear performance management arrangements for the NHS that Christine and others within the Scottish Government will be supporting boards to make sure that they deliver, whether it's on their financial performance or on their performance, patient-facing performance targets. Each board will obviously develop their local delivery plan, which will really set out what they're going to deliver for the resources they get, and that gives visibility to the priorities. We would expect them very much to reflect what was published yesterday in the delivery plan for NHS and care services, so demonstrating a shift in the balance of care, making sure that they are investing in the preventive measures and all of the things that we know will make a difference in those community health services. There are the opportunities, as we laid out yesterday, to look at some of the support functions and how through regionalisation and making sure that boards are working together across regions, whether that's on clinical networks and providing more sustainability to rotas and so on and so forth, or whether it's support functions that support our NHS, that we can deliver those on a more efficient basis. Christine and her team are working with boards on some of the specific detail around that to make sure that what we know is working, and we've got a list of good examples of what boards are doing in some parts of the country, that is shared, and we take a kind of once for Scotland approach, which is if it's working somewhere well and driving efficiency and making sure that money can then be invested in patient care, then we would expect boards to do that everywhere.
Yep. Okay, thanks. And just very quickly, the final point was following up on what Alison Johnson had talked about, was clearly it's a big interconnected thing, and there's other stuff happening in other Cabinet Secretary's budget areas that will have an impact on health. Active travel is an obvious one, but there could well be other areas, be it in obviously a bit of housing, it improves health outcomes, etc., etc., etc. I mean, are there other areas where you're having conversations or looking at other spend areas are outside your remit and having the conversation around about if we spend more on this, then it's going to save money on the health budget in the medium to long term. So I think it's important that we have those conversations with some real data behind them if we're moving forward seriously on the preventative agenda.
Yes, we are. And if you look at some of the education spend on the attainment challenge, for example, a lot of it is around very much ensuring that children get the best start in life, that through education and support, childcare support as well, that we're avoiding people ending up using NHS services if we can, through early intervention, early years intervention, things like family nurse partnership as well, health visitor investment, all of these things align to try to prevent ill health in later life. So yes, very much so.
Okay. Thank you.
Final contribution, Claire.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. I'll be very brief, Cabinet Secretary, I'm mindful of time. We were fortunate enough to hear some evidence a few weeks ago from Sir Harry Burns about the target review that he's doing, and he spoke there about some of the concerns that there were about targets skewing performance and being a tick box exercise. I wonder if you could tell us how you anticipate this draft budget will shift the focus onto the improvement agenda, and also if there is any specific funding for programmes such as the Scottish Patient Safety Programme.
Mm-hmm. Well, the work of the Scottish Patient Safety Programme continues and is very important in making sure that our services are as safe as they can be, and the focus has moved from not just acute care but looking at other parts of the system and community health services as well. So that work and investment continues. The target review is obviously ongoing, and Harry Burns is talking to a number of important stakeholders who will have a view, whether it's the patient view or indeed the staff view. And I think where there's consensus is that we should be focusing more on outcomes. His work is ongoing, so he's getting on with that. I will await his report in the spring, and I'm sure he will help to make sure that what we're measuring are the right things that reflect more the integrated system that we now work in, and can ensure that our resources are delivering in the best way possible. So it is an important part of the changes that we need to make.
Okay. I know time is short, Cabinet Secretary. Maybe when you're responding to us with some of the written information that could come with, if you could also address the issue of the NPD situation, where money has gone from off balance sheet to on balance sheet, and what the implications of that are for capital spending within the NHS. That would be very helpful as well.
Okay.
That's the end of our meeting today, and I would like to close the meeting and wish everybody a very healthy and sporting new year and have a good festive season.